as well. So it's like light both means that it can be light in that it doesn't weigh that much. So like this is very light, you can throw it around. And it's also light as in the snow, it's very light, it's bright. And an atmosphere can be light where it's like easy and slow. And this is some of the things that we wanted to connect with the festival as well. About 5 years ago, at Knudepunkt in Denmark, or it's 4 years ago, I guess, we made this Black Box Horsens, which was a more normal black box event. It's a festival where we invite designers to come and bring their LARPs. It's very open, like anyone can come and put and sign up with their LARP and send an application, and we will review the LARP and see this is a good LARP or this is not a good LARP or it fits or not. And when people bought tickets, they bought tickets for the individual LARP, so people could just buy for one LARP and then just leave again. But the problem was that Horsens was very far away from everything, and there was not really a local LARPer community. So it meant that there was no people you could couchsurf as, and there was nothing else in the city. So it meant that the format of Black Box Horsens didn't really work that well, because we had these people going there, and we had sort of mirrored it from Black Box Copenhagen and Grænselandet, where you are in Oslo and Copenhagen, and there's all these LARPers and all these people, and there's all this other stuff you can do outside of playing the LARPs. But at Black Box Horsens, there was not really anything else. So we wanted to sort of change it, but instead of just changing it, we thought that maybe we should call it something different and make a new kind of event that would be more fitting for sort of the context and sort of the conditions that we had in Horsens, the city that we were doing the event. So we tried to sort of rethink the whole thing for that. I have to press this once in a while. I'll come to the pictures later, but for now you can just envision me talking to you both at the event and also here. That was a bit distracting. But we wanted to sort of fit the conditions for where we were. We wanted to make it smaller. In Denmark, at least, there's a lot of focus on things should be bigger and better and crazier and more extravagant. We need to go to castles, we need to have LARPs needs to cost 500 euros, and it needs to be crazier and wilder. Whereas light was completely opposite. We only had 3 participants, but yeah, we changed it to be smaller instead of being bigger, which is, I think, at the time, a sort of a weird way to go, where everyone wants to make it bigger and better, we wanted to make it smaller and more focused. So one of the ways that we thought that we wanted to do it was that we wanted to be so that everyone who went to the event had to play all the LARPs. So everyone played the same LARPs and they all played the same runs. So it was not like a lot of small LARPs and people played in different runs. Everyone played the same LARP at the same time together. Also the organizers and the volunteers, so everyone who was there was participating. Because in this way, you were not dependent on the community in Horsens or an outside of the event. You were much more dependent on the community at the event. And everybody could, in the breaks or in between the LARPs, everyone could talk about the experience and sort of build upon that. And that's something that I think was very, very powerful for the participants to sort of consider that instead, whereas what happened before in Black Box Horsens, what the people were like, okay, so we're just going to go to the city and look a bit around, and we don't really have a strategy, so we just do nothing. But this time it was like, okay, now we're a group together, or everyone goes as a collective and try to look at the city, we go a trip together, or we stay at the house and talk about the labs. So I think this was sort of a much better iteration and a much better fix. Beyond this, we also wanted to challenge the authors or the designers. So instead of just having an open call where we say everyone can bring their LARPs and then we hope that some cool LARPs come, we were like, we want to find some people that we think is super cool, and we want to make a specific invitation for them and say that these kinds of LARPs that you're making, they're super interesting, could you make something similar at our event? And that's basically what we did, and that's one of the design groups that we invited that are sitting here. And we were like, we gave them a couple of words that we sort of, we tried to look at what they had done as labs, and then we chose some words, and we're gonna look specifically about some of the invitations that we gave people a bit later. But we chose a set of words, and we chose a time of day, because light was connected with sort of the sunrise and sunset and sort of the sun. So we wanted to sort of be very, we wanted to have the theme sort of go through the whole event, and also in our way of inviting the designers as well. But yeah, so we had this, there was one of the core things, having sort of a focused attention to designers. And because we have fewer designers, we also had much more time for all the designers. Because normally at Black Box Horsens, we have 18 different design groups. And with 18 different design groups, you don't have that much time to talk with every one of them about how they should work their lab and how the location works and improve everything. But with three design groups, just three of them, we could spend much more time on each of them. And that was a huge benefit, because it meant that we could discuss much more with them how was the location, what was the facilities, which kind of ideas do we had for their lab. And I think, and you may correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was also a greater experience for the designers themselves, that there was more time for their questions, there was more time for them for having this ongoing discussion about what was going on. So I would argue that it made a better quality of labs doing this process. So sort of quality over quantity. But yeah, I want to talk a little bit about the challenges a little bit more specifically, because we had three different challenges for each group, or sort of three different sets of choices they had to make as part of the design process. So we said to them that you can choose between three different settings, three different societies or sort of culture groups, and three different, what was it? Well, let me just make sure I get it all right. So there's the culture group, and the character creation. We also had sort of a way that they would create characters, and we wanted to sort of influence that and say that you need to use this kind of model as inspiration for the character creation. And I'm just gonna go through it and pass around the papers. So first we can look a little bit about the society they had to choose from. So for example, we had the sunset, and the sunset, they had sort of a core theme of their society that it would be the nomad. And as the nomad, we sort of put some words about what this means. So it's something about seeking new shores, finding new opportunities. Maybe they're fleeing from something, but it's people that are moving around for different reasons. So that was sort of an important thing for how they should create their lab. They should think about nomads within their lab. But then they could choose between three different kinds of nomads. So you can either choose between the pilgrim. So the pilgrim is someone who moves around with a very clear purpose of going somewhere, going to a specific position or place, or like the pilgrimage to Mecca, for example. So someone who wants to go somewhere to see a place, and that's why they're leaving their home. Another group they could choose between was the explorer. Someone who doesn't have a fixed destination, but they want to explore, they want to see new areas. They might be well-funded, they might have wealth with them. Maybe they're paid by someone to go and find new lands and new riches. But the motivation for them to not have a home is to sort of find the great unknown. And then the last group that they could choose was the refugee. So you could also be a nomad because you were fleeing from something. And that could be anything. It could be the climate, it could be war, it could be lack of resources, or it could be anything in between. But something that the reason you were a nomad was because you were a refugee. And this was a way that we sort of challenged our sort of authors and said, you have to choose between these kind of societies within your lab to sort of, yeah, to give them something to think about. We tried to make it so that it was open for interpretation. It was meant as an inspiration. We didn't want to have it like, it has to be exactly like this, but more as like, it would be cool if you think about this within your confines of the lab. But I'm just gonna pass this around, so you can like look a little bit on it and pass it on. So there was the three different groups, and they had three different sets of societies that they had to choose from. So beyond these kind of challenges, we had another challenge, which was about the location. So it was in a black box. So that was already set. So like the physical space was already set. But what kind of location would it be in the fiction? That was open for them to decide. But we had decided on some sort of restrictions still that they had to choose between, similar to what we did with the society and the culture groups. So the locations, for one of the groups was the sea. So something related to the sea. And this again, we divided into three subcategories that they had to choose one of these subcategories as their place. And the first one they could choose was the ship. So that's probably the most natural thing to think about when you think of the sea. You think of a ship sailing around. So this is some location where you're clearly in movement and you're clearly going somewhere. But you're still locked within this confines of the ship. You cannot walk out of the ship. And that's something that might be, that's something that could be relevant and could be shown within the black box game. You could have areas in the black box where you would say you cannot leave this area because then you would leave the ship and you would fall into the water and you would die. So it was again ways to inspire our authors through giving them some restrictions. Another position could be the beach. And something that we said about the beach that was interesting was that you could, if you're standing on a beach, obviously you could just have a beach party and you could just be on the beach because it's nice. But we had some words that we tried to connect with the beach, which was longing. So you're longing for someone or maybe somewhere. Maybe you're standing on a beach and you're looking at, a good example could be in Denmark, you're looking to Sweden. So maybe there's someone on the other side in Sweden that you want to get to. Or maybe you just want to see Sweden and you are standing on the beach looking at Sweden. So there was some longing here. There's a horizon that's very important. That's generally a thing with the sea, you can always see a horizon. You can always see a horizon, but it's a very fixed horizon line. But you want to find something, you're sort of trying to get somewhere, but there's a clear barrier. You cannot go further. Maybe you can swim a little bit, but you have a clear barrier in front of you. And then the last part of this, of sea destination or locations you could choose from, was the bridge. And the bridge is, unlike both the beach and the ship, also it's more about movement, but it's fixed. So the ship, it can move itself, but the bridge can't move, but you can move on the bridge. So there was these three different ways of looking at the sea that had some different connotations with it. And a bridge is often connected with sort of being connection between different groups. The bridge could be a more metaphorical bridge. But it can also be connected with a test or a challenge. Like the story about the trolls underneath the bridge and you have to cross the bridge, but then the trolls come and this kind of stuff. So that was sort of the three parameters that they had to choose between when they were looking at location. I'm just going to pass this around, I'm not going to go through all the challenges for all the groups, but there are some other groups as well that had other kinds of challenges. And I wanted to sort of spend some time and talking about why these challenges was really interesting. And I think another great thing about the challenges was also making them. And I think that's something that we sometimes forget, is to have a lot of fun in creating an event. Sometimes it's very much about, we just want to create an event because someone has to do it or this kind of stuff. But we were like, we were making black box horses, and it was fine, but it was sort of the same thing. But we also wanted to create something. We wanted to be creative. We wanted to put our mark on it. And this was a way for us as organizers of the event, the practical organizers, to also add something to the story. But without sort of, we're making a festival, we make our own labs, because that also feels kind of weird. So instead we sort of like, we want to influence the labs, and that felt like a nice way to sort of get some creative output, and but still be the facilitators of someone else creating something. So it was like a nice middle ground, and it was a lot of fun sitting at the organizing group and coming up with these different challenges. That's something that I really genuinely want to say, that it was so fun to make these challenges for these groups. We were thinking about your group, and we're like, oh, how can we challenge you in this way and that way, and what fits with the lab that you already made before, and is there some way? And sometimes it was also like, we had an idea and we didn't want to kill it, so we had to fit you with the idea. And there was a lot of interesting challenges that we sort of came around in creating this event. And because we had so much more time that we didn't spend on the big bureaucracy of having a lot of groups and a lot of people and a big event and a lot of everything, we could focus much more on what was fun, which was creating, for example, these challenges. So the last set of challenges for each group, which is the most extensive paper one, is the one about character building. So a few years ago at Knudepunkt, I wrote about how you can use the Myers-Briggs typology model in character creation. And the Myers-Briggs typology is sort of a pretty well-known way of using typology based on Jung's psychoanalytical ideas of how the hero and the hero's journey and that. You can read a little bit more about it, and I don't want to sort of explain it now, but just want to say that it was one of the inspirations for making this kind of challenge. Because in creating characters, you can go about it in many different ways. I think most people, they just get some ideas and they just start writing, and that's how it sort of builds upon. Maybe they get to a holding point, and then they try to do some methods to sort of move along. But we wanted to sort of give people some more structured ways, or at least some structured inspiration on how they could go about creating the characters. So again, I will read through the first three challenges for the one of the groups, and the three things they could choose between. The first group was based on spirituality. So it was a spiritual way to create characters. That was sort of the topping word. And then they had to choose between either using chakras, so the ideas of chakras and the different chakras in the body, and somehow use that as an inspiration point on creating the characters. And the second idea was tarot cards. So this idea of flipping cards in a specific order, and then people's fate are decided by what kind of archetypes that are presented on the cards. So this was the second thing they could choose between. So they could either do chakras or they can do tarot cards. And then the last thing they could choose between was then the numerology. So using numbers and sort of dates and stuff like this to sort of alter the way that they would sort of create the characters. Maybe players had to choose between numbers and then they would get the character. It was very much meant as inspiration, so they can use it in different ways, but it was just a starting point. And there's a lot of different sort of points here, and I can just pass it along and you can look a little through some of the different ways. And it was also just meant as sort of like putting a lot of stuff to the groups and be like, here's all these fun ideas, like see if you can get something out of it. And some of it was probably more easy than others. We had one of the groups really struggle with some of it, but then we tell them that use it just as inspiration. You don't have to, like, it's not a hard challenge in that sense. But I think that it really helped in this creation process. And again, it was much more engaging for ourselves to go in this style of creation. I'm just seeing here if there's some important points. I know it's a good time. Okay, we have about 10 minutes. Good. So, again, really want to hammer home this point about less is more. It's a bit ironical because I've made College of History and it was a really big lab, and it's sort of the one of the plans there was to get as many players as possible in a big castle and have as big a budget as possible. But I think at the same time, doing something like light is a good counterweight to make something really small and focus on just with fewer people. There's also more strong connections and it's easier to get your sort of your points about. And there was something really interesting that also happened in the process of playing the LARPs and being at the event, because we were fewer people and everyone was playing the same LARPs. So I think especially for introverted people, they had a much better possibility to shine. Because maybe the first LARP, the extroverted people, they took up a lot of space. And they were really quick at sort of getting, yeah, my character, I'm going to be the big one, I'm going to take up a lot of space because that's what I like and that's what I know. But because we were the same group and we didn't play the second LARP, the extroverted people maybe wanted to be something different. So they were looking at characters that were a little bit more introverted, and the introverted, all the way around, maybe look at the extroverted characters. So we would, by playing all these different LARPs together at the same group in one stretch event, and with some breaks in between, we could sort of really go and try different things. And I think it's actually pretty funny right now, there's a lot of talk about typecasting on the Facebook right now, where a lot of people are sharing all these like Facebook, I'm always getting typecast, can you give me some ideas and some gifts on how to not get typecast? I'm just gonna do this so it doesn't. And I think this might be a method to just play a bunch of LARPs together with the same people in a short amount of time, for example, in a festival like this. Because then you can really get to feel that, I play this thing, so I want to play something completely different. And it's much easier to see like this than it is if you play like, you sign up for one LARP and you're going to play that in like six months. And then you sign up for another LARP and you play that in 6 months. And it's like, it's so far away. And when you're planning it, you have a very different idea than when you're playing it. And there's like all these things that happens in these like big scope projects that you're more likely to end up in the same situation. Because you're like, oh yeah, I'm really busy with all other stuff. And now suddenly LARP, now I have to make a decision right now if I have to want to play character 1, 3, or 5. And I just end up taking the one that sort of speaks to me right now, which is obviously the one that I usually end up with. But I think in this kind of process where we play these LARPs closer together, it's much easier to go against the typecast. Yeah. So before we get to the pictures, just what is the point of this? I think the point is just to say that, again, this event is much easier to make than really big events. So thinking small, and thinking fewer participants, and thinking fewer designers can be really rewarding for you as organizers or designers, or if you want to make your own Black Box Festival, to think, let's just have 20 people go there instead of having 50 people, or let's just have 10 people instead of having 30. That can really have a lot of value, even though we might not, as we heard about in the IX talk, we might not be able to change the world by having 1,000 people go there and have a lot of impact, but we might have a much bigger impact on those people who are there. So that's that. But I just briefly, before we have 5 minutes left, so I just want to go through the pictures so you can also enjoy that a little bit. There's not that many pictures because it was only 3 LARPs, and Black Box LARPs is difficult to capture on the photo, but I think because we also had fewer LARPs, we could really spend more energy on capturing some good photos with those that we had. So this was how we opened the event. We were all dressed up in either white or black clothing. You could choose one or the other. Some of the LARPs were only black, some of the LARPs were only white. This is pretty normal in Black Box events, that you want to have a neutral color so you don't disturb sort of the noise in the LARP. And then we had the teddy, the sharing teddy, so everybody would be talking and they would be giving on the teddy. So it was like a Runda thing. So this is probably pretty difficult to see, but this was our prism lab, which was the fourth lab that we tried to mix all labs together, and we had people were walking down in the corridors, and there was all these like small lights that would be illuminating the corridors. So we tried to make a black box lab with four different black boxes, and it was pretty complicated, and it was pretty confusing, I think, for most of the players. But it was an interesting experiment, and I think because we were fewer people, it was also easier to sort of make something that was a little bit hard to understand and try to still make it work. Then there was one of the groups that made this lab. I can't remember that there was this kind of Holy Spirit. Can't remember the name of it. But somehow the Holy Spirit has made this holy text. And they were reading aloud from it. And they were talking about that we were in this like spiritual retreat. And this being sort of talked to us somehow, and it was a very, I think it was non-verbal lab as well, except for the guides that were just saying stuff, and we were just not saying stuff, we were just looking around, playing with all these like small objects around there. And we might get to some of the objects a bit later, but let's just go to this one. So I think the first lab that we played was this, there was this sky, sort of like stars in the sky, and we were playing these like light beams or like starlight, and our mission was to find some wishes, and then make those wishes come true, and then we would burst as a shooting star. And this was part of the scenography, this tree with the lights, and it would look really beautiful when you were laying on the floor and looking up. You can see the tree back here again. Yeah. So one of the workshops had this really nice thing where you would draw your character's motivation or maybe the dream that you were looking for. And I think this is also something that was really nice, having a longer period together. We could sort of explore different methods of getting into character, creating our character, building our characters. And this method of sort of like drawing to inspire getting to character was really interesting. Here you can see this is from the, what was the name of the lab? When Stars Meet, yeah. So this is the wishes, if I remember correctly, that we could take from the wall. We had written them in the pre-workshop, and then we could take the wishes, and then we could, during the lab, we could make them come true. So here you see them writing the wishes. Here we are, now we are dancing around as the stars, and trying to figure out what it means to be a star in the sky. That was difficult, but interesting. As you see, people are doing different stuff, and they had these really nice decorations in the sort of the ceiling with all these things that were supposed to look like starlight. The tree again here. And then we had the first lab that we played, which is called Spellbound. And it was also, I think it was also sent to Stockholm Scenario Festival and other places. I have to really wrap up. But it had a really interesting idea about these masks that represented these like spellbound creatures that would go to a village and they would spellbound people. And through dance, they would lure them through this portal here into the world of the magical beings. And to sort of show who were the magical beings, they all had these masks, and the rest of us, we just had our normal faces. You can see one of the really, really cool masks, the moon mask. And they just visually, they look great, and they really added something. And there was kind of this dance between people, so they had this method of like, you could like call people over, or you could send them away. And there was this mirroring workshop where you learned how to sort of play out the spellbound thing. Here we have some smoke on the water from the tree. So this was part of the, I can't remember the, but
It was one of the really nice effects that they had found out to make smoke inside that was not going all over the room and then making the smoke detectors. I can't remember exactly how it's done, but it was something that I was like, okay, this is super cool, and I need to find out more about this. And yeah, a lot of sitting in circles and sharing and preparing for labs and hearing. And I think also, again, there's something nice when everyone is looking the same and having the same kind of clothing. It becomes a kind of a community that is something to consider as well. Obviously, it also plays into some of the cultish tendencies that I talked about. And here you can see the portal in normal daylight. I think it's one of the last pictures. And this is some of the scenography they had in the spellbound world. So this is some of the stuff that they would lure people into this party that they were having. This was the end of when you gave away the wishes. You would give them in these containers, and then there would be the sort of the end of the blob for you, and you would shoot along as a star. This, I think, one of the first people going through the portal into the realm of the elves, preparing one of the labs. I think it's also worth noting that this location that we had, it's like a theater place. They have a really nice place with all the mirrors, and there's a lot of stuff. They have like a lot of theater stuff in the corridors that really makes it a nice place to be. So that's also why we really wanted to show it off a little bit more. And sort of include that in the experience. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think there's not much more. This was how we started and ended the event. It's also something that is a little bit smaller. You can do something a little bit more ritualized. So everyone would get an amulet. This the name tags on them, and then you would have your amulet, and everyone would get that at the beginning, and you would say a word that you connected with the event that you expected. You would take your amulet, you would put it on, you would wear it for the rest of the event, and then at the end of the event, you would have to give it away. So like entering the magic circle and leaving it again. And I think this was a very powerful ritual for the people who were there to sort of put all this memory and energy into this amulet and then have to leave it or give it away. And I think it was a really nice ritual that is something that is difficult to make work if you are like 50 people or 100 people. But if you're 20, it's a really, really nice thing to add. And it's just to say that if you think smaller, you can allow for much more interesting stuff to happen as well. So yeah, I think this is a nice one to end at. So this is just sort of a short story about the Light Festival. And if we had more time, which we don't, I would have loved to have you say something about your experience with it as designers. But thank you so much for listening.
Thank you.
And that's that.